Hello everyone, and welcome to this webinar dedicated to the 3D experience meshing capabilities for structural parts and fluid applications. So my name is David Da Silva. I'm in charge of business development of simulation at Kionis. And during this 20 minutes, I will present you the capabilities of the 3D experience. If you want to have more information about simulation, you can go on our website www.kionis.com/simulation, and you will find a lot of information regarding the products, and you will also find a lot of tutorials and knowledge base in order to find more technical information. You will also find the replay of all of this webinar. So the agenda of today will be split in four parts. Firstly, we will introduce what is the 3D experience. Then we will talk about collaboration, which is the main capabilities of the platform offered by the 3D experience. And we will go more on details about meshing capability and see some scenario of what we can do with the 3D experience on meshing and simulation. And lastly, we will give you some frequently asked question about the 3D experience. So let's start with the 3D experience introduction. So the 3D experience, it's a platform. It's a business platform. His main key benefit is to give to the user the same experience regarding the several application can offer. So it's improve a lot of your learning curve. It will give you the capability to customize your dashboard, your business dashboard, in order to capture all your information and customize it regarding to your needs, in order to help you to take decision. The platform is an open platform, so the goal is to give you the capability to collaborate not only with the engineering team but also with sales, marketing, procurement, finance, and manufacturing. So it's a, as I said, a business platform, and in this platform your goal is to share content, to collaborate, and it also offers you a social collaboration platform to more easily interact with your team or with your customer, in fact, because you can integrate your customer in the platform. The platform can be deployed on site, on premise, but it can be also deployed on the cloud. So it's in few seconds you can deploy a 3D experience on your company. And lastly, the platform is totally configurable. That means you can choose which product you want to have on your platform. You can take just product roles for simulation, for project management, maybe for data management, for manufacturing. So you are free to select the roles regarding to your needs. You can start really small and enhance the product over the time. So why do simulation and 3D experience, what we do 3D experience on simulation? The goal of the platform 3D experience on simulation is to propose an unique environment dedicated to simulation. So it's fully natively integrated to the CAD and will give you all a full digital continuity with a PLM integrated. Okay, so this will offer you a capability to collaborate, to explore your design more easily, and create and deploy simulation processes. That means the goal is to democratize simulation, and it can be done by capturing processes by process expert, method process expert, and deploy it to non-specialist users. And finally, the goal of the platform is to give you all the capability to analyze and understand your products instead of taking your time to set up and doing pre and post-processing. So non added value approach. So if we go more in details, so if you want to select some application on the Swift experience, you need to buy a role. So a role, it's a part of the platform dedicated to a specific application. So for simulation, you have multiple roles, as you've seen here. I will not go in details, but you have roles dedicated for designers, role dedicated to simulation expert, role to capture process and deploy the process, role for a multi-physics application for fluids, plastic injection simulation, and so on. So you will select the application you need regarding what you want to deploy. So usually a role, it's an engineer or it's a designer who want to do something, and we will propose a role relating to his needs. So as I said, you select a role. For this example, you select structural analysis, and what you will have, in fact, a role give you access to a certain number of application. So here you can see this application, and this application, each application give you access to a tool of a set of tools. For example, here you have the tools to set up loads, boundary condition, and so on. So let's talk about the main added value of the platform, which is collaboration. So the main goal of the platform is to remove the silos between designer and analyst. The goal is to have a full continuity from design to simulation, and it will help you to reduce loops between these two teams. So usually, if you look at today, you have designer using CATIA V5 or NX or other CAD software. So that means they are using a specific GUI. They maybe are not trained to use this tool, and maybe they don't have expertise. So the main challenge, if you want to give simulation to this users, you need to propose something which are integrated to their environment. And most of the time, sorry, come back to the slide. Most of the time, the simulation analysts are using a different environment, and the connection of CAD and simulation are not fully integrated. So the idea is to propose a similar environment in order to be able to have designer which can use simulation, but we will see this simulation will be customized to their knowledge. That means it need be user-friendly. And the idea is to give them the capability to share simulation data to a simulation analyst, and to talk about with some mo the data model. So that mean for us, if we talk about of Abaqus, of structural analysis, so in Dassault system ecosystem, the software is Abaqus. So that mean we are using the same solver, Abaqus in that case, for designer and analysis. This will give the opportunity to do a setup of simulation do their basic simulation. And if they find some difficulty, they share to simulation specialist, and the simulation specialist can take the model from the designer in the same in their own environment, on the specialist environment, and be able to modify and try to find the issue on this simulation. So they are working in the same environment, same data model, and that's the main objective. Of course, for designer, the environment will not be the same as the environment for a specialist. So, as you can see here, this is an example of a setup of simulation for designer. So, for designer, you need to guide the user to set up the model. So, you have an assistant workflow which will help the user to set up their simulation. So it's quite straightforward. You define the parts you want to simulate, materials, define contact if you have contact, define your connection on the part, the boundary condition, the load, and you do the simulation. So you limit the users to go on technical features really specific to simulation. So it's quite straightforward. But in fact, behind this user experience, there is nothing else than Abacus running. So that means you give at the hand the same tool, Abacus, which is for a specialist, but you dedicate the environment to be used by designer. So that means for the meshing, you don't show meshing capability. It's fully automated with automatic refinement, for example, for reducing the mesh on specific area automatically. That means the users don't focus on FEA capability. So this is this application come from the role stress designer, a stress engineer, sorry. So it's a role dedicated to a designer who want to do some stress simulation. Okay, so let's look at another example. So this is another example from user using Katia V5 and the platform. In that case, we consider that the designer don't have the 3D experience for design, and is still using Katia V5. You could do the same thing with NX or Creo with what we call Power BI, which connect a legacy CAD product to the platform. So here we just import the CAD file. It's a CAD product on the platform. So this is a here it's a pipe, a fluid pipe. So here you because it's a Katia V5 file, you are able to have all the feature tree, and you go directly to the structural validation application, and you do your simulation setup. So it's the same workflow as seen before. So you define your material, restraint, boundary condition, loads, and so on. Or here we just do some boundary condition on each side, define a load on the faces, and we will submit the simulation. So here we have the first result. Okay, the designer is looking to the result and see then that the result is not what he will expect, so it don't meet the requirement. So he want to do an update on the CAD tool and try to improve the design. So if I go directly to this step, so what he does, he do a new version of Katia, and it will update the original part by a new one. So it will automatically create a new version, like with the life cycle management. So we create a new revision of the initial part. And you just need to update the initial simulation. So you open your last simulation and the solution will automatically update the part by the new one. Say, okay, maybe you can lost some faces while you define the load because they don't exist anymore. That's the case here because they changed drastically the design and they can submit the job. Okay, so you are the full integration of CAD and simulation. Okay, so here we are giving to a designer a capability to do simulation. So, and the tool need to be really robust, and that's the power of Abacus, to be given to the designer in order to be able to do some advanced simulation. So that's why in terms of interface, you can see that meshing, you don't talk about meshing, you talk about, okay, do you want a coarse, fine results? Do you want to use adaptive meshing to update automatically the meshing and to be sure that you have a meshing convergence? If you want to give some contact capabilities, so contact is non-linear capabilities, usually is used by designer. So you need to improve the contact definition, and here just an example of capabilities. So with the contact in Abacus, you can use general contact, so it's not necessary to define all the face which are potentially in contact. So you have general contact, automatic contact detection, and you have also geometric correction to improve the contact between curved surface. So this is based on the CATIA geometric modeler, which compute the correction, geometric correction, to have a precise contact on a curved surface. Okay. So as I said, this is some capabilities. Now let's go more in details on the data structure of simulation on the platform. The data structure is how you define the simulation. The simulation on the platform is defined in three parts. You have the model, where you have the CAD and the mesh. You have the scenario, where you set up your scenario of simulation, and you have the results. This structure allows you to easily update the model, but keep the scenario and just update the result. So that's allow you to quickly rerun simulation. If you go on the model structure, you can manage multiple mesh on a CAD structure. That means if you have an assembly of parts, you can say, okay, I have a multiple meshing, okay, regarding to several application. For example, you want to have a mesh for NVH with a fine meshing, another mesh for NVH with rough meshing, another one for crash, which more coarse mesh, for example, and you can have the same thing on the part level. So this gives you clearly the capability to link CAD and meshing, to have multiple meshing on your CAD, and to do some reuse. So you can have a reuse of your specific mesh of one part of or from a full assembly. So let's continue on some capabilities. If you want to collaborate and democratize the simulation, you need also to create some rules of meshing. So for doing that, we are using rules-based meshing application, which give you the capability to define some rules for the parameter of meshing. Okay, so you set up what kind of mesh you want, what kind of geometry simplification you want to apply. For example, you can define some specific meshing for fillet, for 3D holes, and so on. And all these features can be saved and apply on any new CAD model. So clearly, the platform is fully associative with CAD, with native CATIA 3 experience, or with external CAD software like CATIA, NX, and Creo, for example, or SolidWorks, of course. You can easily share a simulation model between designer and a specialist because you are sharing the same simulation object and you are using the same solver. For the meshing, can manage your meshing like you can manage your CAD. So you can have a life cycle of management of your mesh. You can have for one CAD multiple mesh and so on. And the user interface can be is fully customized regarding to the users. Okay. So let's go more in depth and look at the features capability of meshing in the platform and what it can be give you more capability regarding to the product you have today. Let's take the example of partition exam meshing on the platform. Usually, if you want to reduce the number of elements and you want to have some more precise result, you can do exam meshing. But exam meshing need to do some partitioning. So sometimes it's quite easy to partition your parts to have an exam meshing, but sometimes there is some area which are quite complicated and you are not able to partition it. So now you can do all your partition. So here in yellow, it's a part which can be meshed in EXA. And the rest, which are not able to be meshed on EXA, will be meshed in Tetra Element. And the transition between Tetra and EXA will be conformal. What does it mean? The transition between the Tetra EXA will be done by a pyramid element between EXA and then you take the face of one EXA and you have a pyramid and you go to the Tetra. So this allow you to have a conforming meshing. So you have no more singularity compared to the other approach that you can continue to do, which is doing EXA, then directly go on Tetra and have a tight constraint between both. Okay, so you can do both now. Of course, we clearly recommend to use conforming meshing. Another application of improvement for meshing is for CFD. So fluid simulation dynamic simulation. So here you are analyzing the fluid behavior, and we have also created a new algorithm, which is called HDM meshing. It's for EXA dominant meshing. So it try to put the maximum of EXA element on the part, then do the transition with the boundaries of the geometry with Tetra element. Of course, you manage also the boundary meshing for your CFD part. So here, the improvement is to not use always the same meshing. So you can have coarse area because you don't have a lot of curvature and some other area, you refine the mesh. So you can reduce by 3 or 4 times the number of cells for the same results. Okay, so here you are reducing from 1 million of elements to 250K elements with the same results. So that's clearly an improvement of simulation speed. Okay, so how is it complex to set up this kind of meshing? In fact, it's quite easy. You have your part. So you just have your structural part, and in fact, you just say, okay, I have an internal fluid. You select the inner face, and you define your inlet and outlet, and automatically the tool will generate the exam machine for the fluid cavity. If you want to do a conjugate heat transfer, so you want to take into account the thermal transfer between structural and exa, you can also mesh the tetra part, the structural part with tetra meshing, for example, and take into account this behavior on the simulation. So here you just have defined the inlet outlet. So this defines a region of a fluid where you apply the material. In that case, it's the air, and you define your boundary condition. So you have a velocity inlet and a drop pressure of zero usually at the end. Okay. And I would say that you just have to set up your minimal size, maximum size, the number of your boundary layers for the exam meshing, and it's done. It will generate automatically the mesh. So as you can see here, if you show only the mesh, so you have this result. And as you can see, this result is an adaptive meshing with internally you have exa element, okay, quite coarse. Then you can see the exa element is reduced, and then you have your boundary layers on the boundary of your geometry. And of course, you set up your simulation and you post-process. So it's quite straightforward. In fact, you don't need to take care of the meshing setup. It's quite automatic. Okay, so let's continue with some example. Typically, if you are doing a structural simulation, you used to mesh some forged part, for example, here. This is a typical geometry you can have and where you can face a lot of issue of meshing. If you are an Abaqus CI users, you can pass a lot of time to try to clean this geometry, to remove off all these redundant edges. And here, the meshing tool in the platform has really improved, been improved. And here, in just one click, you can have this automatic result. So it's not perfect, but it's clearly better than what we used to have with other tools. Okay, so here is has been done fully automated. Another view, another same part, but just another area. You can see all these details. So nothing has been done in terms of cleaning. We just take the part, apply a size mesh, and you mesh the part, and it's automatic. Of course, you can control. Sorry, you can control edge meshing and so on. If you have your some fillets and hole, you can have more control. But I just wanted to show you here that in one click, the mesh you have is quite correct. Here, this is the same part, and you will look at the meshing. So again, this has been done fully automated. So here, you will see on the platform how we can check the mesh. So here we go on the visualization tool. You show or hide the geometry, okay? Or you show and or hide the meshing. And we will look more in details on the mesh. So you can have here a table with some statistic on the meshing. And what is really, really powerful is you are able to look at the most worst element with an autofocus on it. So most of the time you pass your time to check where is or where are my bad element. Here you have an automatic tool which show you directly where is the baddest, the worst element. So here you have the focus. So here is okay, the focus is good, but in that case, it's on the other side that you have the issue. So you need to turn. But if you don't want to search like that, you just have to check this launch clipping box to just focus on the area And with this clipping box, it will hide all the interest part. As you can see, you can have the color code. Red means you don't respect the criteria. Yellow, it's you are on warning. And green, you are correct. So it's really, really more powerful to check the capability of your mesh. So let's to look now on the full example. So here you have a motorbike, and we will continue to look on some capabilities. So here we have take this part. So yes, you're still on the platform. You are navigating on the your model, and you want to do some simulation on this area. Okay, so you look on your assembly, and you go on the CAD level, and we will look at this part. So now we will go to the simulation capability. On the simulation capability, you can have tool to do some CAD manipulation. Okay, so here you need to look at this more in details. You have here a part which is a geometry which don't have features. Okay, so you have no feature in this part, and we will look at this how we can modify this geometry. So you are using here direct modeling to modify the geometry. So you don't need to modify and have the native geometry. You can do this quite easily on any kind of part. It can be an EGS, a step, or here a geometry without any feature. So that's what we call direct modeling. So this is really useful for doing defeaturing, to remove some little details, to do some what if scenarios. So you have a geometry, you do a simulation, and you just change a little area, a radius, fillet, and so on, without going to the full process of sending your part to the CAD team and so on. So we will continue to look at some capabilities. So here we will do control of the wall thickness. Okay, so this is tool. You are on simulation model preparation tool. So you are on the simulation environment, and you can see here you can detect a small issue on your part. You do a box, and you want to remove some details. In a few clicks, you can remove some unuseful detail. Okay, so now let's go to the meshing. So we will go step by step. So here we have do an automatic meshing. And as you can see that we have the logo of the company. You just can use the remove logo feature to define the feature, remesh, and as you can see, the logo has been removed automatically. So it's a logo detection which allow you to remove. Let's continue. We want to have a more control meshing on the hole. So here we will check the diameter of the hole to apply a specific rules with the good parameters. We will apply also criteria on fillet. You want to have a specific meshing on the fillet. So you apply all the criteria you want. So here, as you can see, you have a specific meshing on the fillet. For the hole, you have two layers elements, and so on. And now, you can, with the walls visualization, look at the results of all your routes you have applied. So we have applied a logo removed. You have applied a specific meshing for some fillet from 2D hole. So here you have, with a color code, all the area which has been impacted by these rules. So you know that, okay, why don't have a good meshing here? That's normal because you have no rules in the area. But on the blue one here, you can see that you have applied rules, and that's why you have a good meshing. And so that's really useful to understand why I have bad or correct meshing on these areas. Okay, and that's not finished. So here, as you see some yellow line, blue line, and so on. So yellow line are the line which has been kept, and the mesh go through this line. But and the blue are line which has been removed. So this has been done automatically. But of course, you can add, as you can see, some additional line, and so on. After that, when you think you're correct, you can go on more local control of your mesh. So you can manipulate nodes, elements, swap edges, and so on to have a more control of your mesh. And the job is done. Okay, so this was a typical process for 3D meshing. Keep in mind that all the setup we have done on the rules can be saved and directly applied on the new model. So now we'll just go quite quick on some hexa meshing capability. So this is a typical part that we could mesh in hexa. So, but you need to do some defeaturing. So I will go quite quick because it's quite similar that the process we've seen before. So you can do box, you focus on the area we want to analyze, remove some faces. As you can see, it's quite user-friendly, the new interface. Okay, so here you are removing holes and so on. After, sorry, I just pass the video. And after that, you just can click and it generates an hexa meshing. Okay, so there is no defeaturing. This kind of part can be meshed automatically in hexa meshing. Okay, let's look at another part, this one. So in that case, we will use another defeaturing tool. So we will use rules for the defeaturing. So here, you define which part you want to mesh, and then you go on the defeaturing tool. You look at the value of radius and so on, and you will apply some defeaturing. So here you are applying rules. Okay, I want to remove fillets between 1 mm and 5 mm, and you apply these rules. So these rules can be updated, removed, or modified at any time. And then you continue your process and you do your mesh. Okay. And this last part is showing also that you can mesh multiple parts with multiple rules automatically. So you have a table with all your parts, you apply some specific rules, and you can mesh 100 or 1,000 of mesh automatically. Or you can also do it on remote, so you can submit this on a cluster to do the meshing. Okay, so all will be based on the roles. Okay. Of course, it's quite fast. The goal is just to give you an overall view of the capability. You have more fit We have more features we can show, but the time is quite limited. We already passed the time, so just wanted to finish with some frequently asked question. So firstly, is it complicated to install the 3D Experience? The answer is quite no. Why we have often this question is because the platform is a collaborative platform, so you need a database. So this database can be installed on your site, and yes, in that case, can be more than a few minutes to install it. But if you don't want to install this database, you can clearly use the cloud. So Dassault will manage all the database from their side, and you just need to install the application. Cool. So the answer is no. Just use the cloud in that case if you don't want to install the platform on your site. Can you combine Abacus CI and the 3D Experience? Yes, of course. You have what we call Power BI Abacus CI, which can connect your CI environment with the platform, and will also help you to do cloud computing. So this will be the topic of your next webinar. And do I need Katia for using 3D Experience? No, it's like Abacus CI, in fact. You can choose only simulation roles and import your CAT files. So it can be CATIA, a STEP, an EJS, and SolidWorks files, an NX file. And you import it, you do your defeaturing if you have some defeaturing, and you do your simulation. So it's quite related to Abaqus CA. So you have CAT capabilities. In fact, in the platform, this CAT capabilities is nothing else than CATIA features. But you don't need to do your design in CATIA V5. And last question, does this platform is more expensive to Abaqus and Abaqus CA legacy product? The answer is no. It depends of what you want to do, but we are clearly on the same price position. Okay, so that's all from me. I hope you enjoyed this webinar. And now, if you have some question, feel free to ask your question through the tool dedicated to that. I'm just checking. I don't see any question. I'll let you few seconds to ask your question. If not, we will close this webinar. Okay, so no specific question. So I would like to thank you everyone to attend to this webinar, and if you want to participate to the new webinar, the next one in English will be on June, and you will receive in few days a week the new invitation. So thank you very much. Have a good lunch and bye bye.